Thank you so much for keeping your channel on TV3. You're still watching Simply Showbiz. My name is Akofa. I mentioned earlier that we'll be having our one-on-one session with two-time Grammy-nominated Rocky Dawuni. He's usually described as a reggae, soul, Afro-roots, musician. Like, that's... I went into it, I'm like, yo, Afro roots, man. We'll be getting into all of that and more right here as well. Now, he joins me in studio. Rocky Dawuni, you're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us today.
It's really an honor to be here.
How are you feeling today? Like,
I'm feeling very good.
Very good?
Yeah.
Calm as well.
And
very
calm,
collected.
You know, I'm home right here in Ghana.
Okay.
You know, and, family, people. I did a little bit of traveling. I would just in the northern region, drove up all the way there and then came back. So, you know, I've just been exploring and experiencing at the country and just really enjoying and being creative, you know.
Right.
So I'm good.
We're really excited to have you join us. Now, I found out that you sort of got this inspiration to be a musician by, you know, seeing the military band perform at Michelle Camp where you grew up.
Yes.
Do you mind, you know, taking us back to that you know, story a little bit?
Well, you know, the thing was that when I was a little kid, I discovered that I had a propensity to, you know, analyze music. Anytime I heard music on the radio, I'll be like, okay, what is the bass playing? What is this playing? So I'll dissect it, you know. So I had that knack. So we on the barracks too had a band, and that band usually was a military band, but they usually did covers.
Okay.
You know, so, you know, there was a lead singer there who I just, when I first saw him play, I was like, I wanted the whole world. I wanted to be like this guy, you know. And then, they will have their rehearsals. Mm. So I'll go to the rehearsals and then check them out. So that was kind of where I started observing like real performance outside of me being a child with a vision.
Okay.
I started observing like, oh, this is how they play. This is the keyboardist. This is the singer. This is how he goes about. And then they rehearse. I'll just watch it. And then, you know, one day they were, you know, rehearsing and playing a lot of reggae music and Bob Marley music, you know, and I just heard some of the songs and I was like, wow, this is kind of really interesting. That was kind of my first connection to reggae. But before all of that, I was exposed to high life music and all the music that made, you know, were the foundational music of Ghana, you know. So, you know, Hot Barrels, as they were called, and then the lead singer, I always mention his name because I'll never forget, you know, his name is Julius Mingle. Was like, I mean, he was such a performer, you know, and I wanted to be like him,
just like him.
And that was kind of how the first music bug.
It's amazing how you get to remember his name,
Julius
Mingle.
Yes.
All that time.
Yes. You don't forget stuff like that.
You know,
there are certain people, you know, as you, you know, you see somebody is on stage and you're like, wow, this guy, you know, he understands this. You know, he understands stagecraft. You know, he sings and his body movements and how he does it. And you are an audience. So you are seen and you're just like, wow, this is a great teacher to learn from. And then me too, I can be able to, if I'm able to you know, learn and take some of these ideas, I can be able to use that to as a musician, a performer, you know. So, you know, you start, you're just looking for people to validate and then also people that you can learn from on your journey.
Now, you've been doing this for a while. Now, let's talk about how it was back then, because definitely you did see some people that inspired you in this space. Now, you've been doing this music stuff for a very long time, because growing up, anytime I hear Rocky Dawuni, I hear in Ghana, so you've been around for a very long time.
Yes.
What would you say is that thing that has kept you, you know, relevant, kept you being talked about all this while?
You know, the thing is, sometimes it's very hard for you to, because you are involved in the process. So when you're supposed to analyze it as an outsider looking in, you know, it's almost like self-serving, you know. But I felt that from the onset, I believed that my path was going to be something that I had to chart and succeed. Regardless of, you know, there was no other option. You know, I believe that music was something that was a gift
okay.
you know, from God, you know, for me. And I discovered my voice, and I wanted to not only be, you know, a musician that will just perform for the sake of popularity and stuff. I wanted to be somebody who could utilize that platform to articulate things, somebody who could utilize that platform to connect people. And so to do that, you have to have a certain sophistication, which is which comes from learning, paying attention, and then hard work and focus. You know, so from the onset, I knew that once you are able to create great songs stand the test of time. If you have great songs and you are able to have great production with it, then that means that those great songs can be able to transcend genres and boundaries and all of that. So with all that knowledge, I knew that I didn't have it all at, you know, whatever level I was. I just had to be constantly innovating and listening and learning and striving for the highest level of excellence. So I think that kind of informed my decisions and my creativity. And I have constantly tried to challenge myself, bring new influences in there. I think that is what has been the key to the longevity, is that constantly innovating, constantly seeking to be better, and then constantly motivated and focused. At the same time, too, being open to new influences.
Right.
You know, because you can be bogged down in your influences or in your, if you are not brave enough to step outside.
To try new things.
Yeah, you know, so I've always been brave enough to be as like, once you can write a great song, you can present it in any way.
Right.
And I think that's all of those things have been very key to create that character mold that I needed, that has been able to navigate, you know, all the challenges that I came across.
That's amazing. Yeah. Now, you mentioned earlier that, you know, great music. A lot of times there's this debate, how do we determine what great music is? Is there something you need to be looking out for?
You know, the thing is that there's no yardstick or baseline as to great music. But the thing about great music is that he who feels it knows it. When you feel it, you know it. You know, there, the music will kind of strike a certain nerve lyrically. It will be so perfect.
Okay.
It will speak to you. It speak at you. It speak for you. And then also rhythmically, it's undeniable. You know, when you hear the music, something in you, I mean, if even you want to stand, the music moves you. You know, it makes you lose your faculties because the music has that magic to it. And I believe that, you know, there's timeless songs that every time they play
it. Sounds fresh.
It just does not, you know, time does not decay it. Time has no power over it, you know. So I think that, you know, that is, that type of music is what I call good music. But then there's certain music too that becomes part of the, shall I say, the time, you know, the fad of the time. And sometimes those things will come and take over for a long time, and many artists will try to find your ways, like either you join or you sink, you know. So the fads, if you're able to still acknowledge the fads, take the best elements out of the fads and still stay relevant to who you are, I think that you're able to kind of transcend all of those things.
I also found out that, you know, you listed, you know, along the line, some of your top-notch moments in your career. You met Stevie Wonder at a point.
Yes.
You performed with him.
Yes, yes.
Tell us a little bit about that.
That's really an amazing story. You know, it's one of the highlights of, you know, as a musician.
Yeah.
You know, I remember, this is a story that I told him when I first had opportunity. We're playing at Hollywood Bowl together.
Yes.
And we're sitting in the back room, and I had this deja vu. You know, like, here's, I was, you know, a kid from Ghana who used to look at the cover of Stevie Wonder's
albums.
And who wanted to be a musician. And then I'm sitting there, and the man is right there, and me and him are talking, and then I'm pinching myself to make
just
sure
to
that...
to be sure you're
to be
there.
Sure that that was happening. You know, it was surreal. You know, Stevie, you know, got to know my music and you know, really, you know, loved it. And when I had the opportunity I had released the album Branches of the Same Tree. Book of Changes. Book of Changes. And Book of Changes at that time too, you know, it came out, it was, you know, Wake the Town was EA video game, you know, the songs were on TV shows.
I've seen that your songs are on lots of games.
Yeah, you know, TV shows. So it was kind of an album that was not reggae. It was first like fully Afro Roots record. But, you know, the reggae fans were a little confused about it and they stayed off it.
Okay.
But then it won a whole new group of fans who embraced it as musical innovation.
Okay.
And so the day that, and at that time too, I had a club in Los Angeles.
Afro Club.
Afro Funky.
Okay.
Yeah. So I decided that I was going to do the concert to launch the album.
Mm-hmm.
So you can imagine there was a huge buzz for that. That day, you know, I mean, as much as your eyes can see, there were lines there to get into the club, you know, for the concert. Everything was, you know, it was huge buzz, mm-hmm. LA Times, LA Weekly, you know, everybody was there to cover the concert. So little did we know, as we were getting ready, you know, all of a sudden there was like this pandemonium that was happening
outside.
And then heard, I get a call from a good friend of mine who was actually, was like, Stevie, It's coming. I'm like, coming where? Like, Stevie's coming to the show. Okay, I'm like, okay, I'm gonna be of the best behavior. I'm never gonna ask him to get on stage. I'm gonna be like the artist that is respectful.
You didn't want to impose.
Exactly, I didn't want to impose. I want him to have a good time. So he came in. I mean, this was like, I mean, there was like bodies packed, you know. The concert started. It was like one of the most powerful shows.
Mm.
You know, music legends like Remy Kabaka, who's played with CB Sign, all these guys were there. And everybody was, you know, and it was a new sound because I was mixing Afro and reggae and all of that. So in the middle of the set, I get tapped on my shoulder. They said, Stevie Wonder says, anytime you want him, he will come on stage. And I'm like, what about right now?
Right now.
So I used the watch. I was like, I'm not going to wait. I announced him.
Yeah.
And he came and it was crazy. And then people started calling, those who were in, who could get into the show, started calling people outside in different parts of Los Angeles, telling them that Stevie Wonder actually showed up. So people were getting on the freeway now. Apart from people couldn't get in, there was people getting on the freeway trying to come. It was incredible. So that was like the first show that he came to show his support for me. And obviously, that was an incredible album.
Mm-hmm.
And then a few years later, then Hollywood Bowl, which is one of the biggest venues in the world and most prestigious.
Okay.
You know, everybody from the Beatles, everybody has, you have to play Hollywood Bowl to arrive.
Is that the one that's got about 18,000
capacity? Yes, about 20,000 capacity.
Okay.
Yeah. Recently, the there was a you know, our brothers in Nigeria did
also
it.
Also went
a,
to...
Yeah, there was a show there and, you know, so, and I saw in our media, most people did not know that I played, you know, so Stevie Wonder, myself, Stevie Wonder. So it was a night that was called Global Sounds, you know, and Stevie was headlining and it featured me and all of these people. And it was like the most amazing, incredible concert.
Right.
So that was during the concert, first of all, that I was sitting backstage, that I had that big deja vu because all of a sudden it dawned on me that here I am playing in one of the most prestigious venues with one of the most amazing legends that I, when I was growing up, I always looked up and looked at the album cover and be like, wow, you know, we are more about true. No, you musicians saying it. One day, you know, like that thing.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden it's coming to him. And I remember on the stage with 20,000 people, and when I got on stage, you know,
the
with
chant,
Stevie, and then Stevie
the
brought
cheering.
Everybody back to come and do Higher Ground with him, with 20,000 people in the most prestigious thing that's going off. I mean, it was really incredible, you know. And for me, those were some of the high points of my career, you know, beyond, and then, you know, obviously after that too, I got to also collaborate with Bono, you know, for Playing for Change, which was also a big, huge release. So, you know, most people don't know, you know, like that there's been a lot of very big high points that have led to what is going on right now.
Yes. Speaking of that, there's a conversation that also, you know, is suggesting that they believe your PR machinery isn't that heavy in Ghana. What do you think?
Oh, I think that is not true, you know. Okay. I mean, you work and you push your work. Obviously, I'm a very determined person to get my music. You know, it's just the challenges are, there's certain challenges that you have to deal with. And when you have a record, some people are playing, some people are not playing, some people are paying attention to it, some people are not paying attention. And then you come and you put the effort that is required and all of that. You know, you can only do what is humanly possible, you know. And then, you know, but I'll say that I've always maintained, you know, even when I travel and I have to do, I always come to Ghana, mm-hmm. do whenever an album is there and push. You know, I, for the last how many years, every year I'm here.
You're
pushing.
Here.
So
yeah.
So it's an erroneous, I think it's just somebody's way of getting a certain kind of attention by making that kind of statement, you know. But, you know, how will I get all of those if the machinery was weak, you know? The machinery is actually one of the most potent, you know?
Okay.
It's just that, you know, Ghana, I've had a long career. You know, I've had peaks, you know, you have certain peaks where everybody knows, and certain peaks where you come, and certain peaks where you, you know, you can't always be
on the top like that.
Oh yeah, on the top like that, okay. You know? So it's been kind of a movement, but you know, I love my home, I love my people, I love my country. And I've always believed that the best way was that our music needed to cross over.
Yeah.
You know, so I've always focused a lot of energy there, whilst a lot of people are here, that we needed to break through so that we can create the pathway for our industry to be able to move. So I've been, you know, a warrior at the forefront, you know.
Right.
So, and then a warrior at the forefront, you can come back and be playing defense whilst you are also out there, you know. So you
protecting
just,
the,
yeah,
the,
you do that to the best of your ability.
Okay.
And, you know, your best of our ability is always not perfect, you know. So I agree to some extent that there's room for more intense promotion and all of that. But as to that, we have not worked diligently for that. You know, we've worked very diligently,
okay.
And I have some amazing people.
You just mentioned crossing over to, you know, the other side, or making your brand a global one at that. How did you break those barriers? Because as it stands now, it's a conversation that's being had where we're finding ways that our artists can also have, they do have the global appeal with what we're seeing right now, but it seems that they had to do it by themselves.
Yeah, but they have it easier. They have it a bit easier because, you know, when I started, you could not have a music and it be heard by somebody outside of your country.
Right.
You didn't have the internet.
Okay.
You know, the internet was there somehow, but it was not social media, viral videos, that kind of, all of a sudden you can sit in your town and then become famous overnight around the world and you haven't even left your town.
Right.
You know,
right.
But at that time you had to have record labels who would take, so like my first album, The Movement, you know, when I started in Legon, you know, our band, you know, Local Crisis, you know, we started getting attention. Then I went to...
Your band was called Local Crisis.
Local Crisis.
Okay, maybe another day.
We'd be university students, you know. The crisis was, you know,
right.
The hustling was very hard.
It was real.
Yeah, that's it was real. So we had to kind of reflect that in our music and all of that. But then, you know, from the onset, you know, when The Movement came out, then what goes around became very popular, and then I got a license to Atlantic Records for a compilation. So that started, you know, all of a sudden I'm on a compilation by a major label, you know, so that started kind of bringing me into the fore. And then by the time Crusade came with In Ghana became a global hit, you know, so I was being booked for reggae festivals, I got my first real tour. You know, when In Ghana happened, I played, you know, Womad Festival and all of these great festivals around the world when In Ghana came, you know. So it's been a journey. Yeah, it's been a journey. It's been a beautiful journey. And when you are focused that, you know, each step you challenge yourself and each step you humble yourself to learn. You know, I like the learning part because that's what has fed my creativity.
All right.
You know, I like to come to Ghana and I'm a fan of like all the new music. And I'm just like, if even some of these musicians see how much I'm a fan and I jump around when I hear their music, they'll be so surprised
because
that is where the inspiration comes from. And I love that, you know, and I think that has informed my innovation and creativity over the
Let's talk about your second Grammy nomination.
Yes,
Best Global Music category
for
Voice of Boom Boom.
Yes,
wanted to get the pronunciation right. Boom Boom, Volume 1.
Yes.
Right? And how did you hear the news? How did it come about?
Somebody was asking me a question. How did you get a Grammy nomination? I'm just like, you tell me, because I don't know.
You don't know?
You know, because you just do the work, you put it out there, you promote it, you elevate it, and you hope that out of the thousands of records that have been released around the world, when they all get into that funnel, into that Grammy consideration, and maybe your genre has about 400 or something entries.
That's a lot.
All of this, 20,000 or how many thousands of Academy members who are voting and listening will eventually decide that you are one of the four.
Wow.
You know, I mean, how do you, you know, I'm just like, there's no way I can really be able to do that, you know, figure that out. But when, what happened was that I had traveled to Boom Boom.
Yeah.
Yeah, which is my
hometown.
My hometown. And my older brother, Ubor Wumbe Dawuni, is the chief there.
Okay.
So he has an annual festival called Linujil that is a yam harvest festival. So it's like all the chiefs, cultural music, everything comes there. So I came, I'd gone to Glasgow for the COP. I came back, I was like, God, Europe is cold and all of that stuff. So I want some culture. You know, came in through everything, took my car, drove all the way, you know, to Boom Boom, and the event started, you know, just was immersed in, you know, local culture, everything. And then I got back to Accra, you know, on the eve of the Grammys.
Mm-hmm.
So I was very tired from the travel and I put my phone off, you know. So when all of that stuff was happening, I was actually in my garden.
Just relaxing.
Like, yeah, relaxing and then, you know, gardening. You know, like checking my contemporary and all my stuff that was growing, you know, and oblivious to it. So I come out and I, you know, turn my phone off and start chatting. And all of a sudden I see like U.S. calls, like a lot of U.S. calls. I'm like, okay, U.S. calls, why are so many different calls coming from the from the U.S.? So then I looked and then there was a call too coming from my manager, you know, and she was getting on a plane and she's like, have you heard the news? I'm like, what news? Like, you've been nominated again for a Grammy. I'm like, nominated by who? You know, it was just you thought like somebody was playing a joke on you. It's like, no, I'm serious. You've been nominated for a Grammy. I'm like, wow, that's amazing, you know, because this album too, I felt was unlike the one that was nominated for the reggae, you know, was a combination of high life Afrobeat using reggae music to create a new sound.
Mm-hmm.
So the voters I knew that saw that this everything sounded the same and this was different. So they gravitated towards it.
Okay.
And then this album too, same thing, because I fused a lot of, you know, from palm wine high life to choral, Ghanaian choral style, from Wulome Jajiloy styles to contemporary music, songwriting, and all of. So I was mixing the really cultural elements, but presenting it in a contemporary way. So I knew that giving a fair chance for the music of people who knew music to listen to the record as against other records is through the chance. But at the same time, you cannot predict what is going to happen. You just put in your work. You put it in your heart. You do the best that is humanly possible. You do the best to, elevate and shed light on it. And then the rest is left up to God's, you know, to God's grace. You know, and I feel that this is something that we as a country, it's important for us, for our industry. You know, last year when I was here, when there was, you know, Ghana didn't have any nomination and our brothers across the pond were, you know, got all the nominations. There was just so much stuff going on in the media and constantly people were calling me, oh, how do we do this? How do you do? I'm just like, how do we do? You know, I don't have the solution, but I did a record that really has the blueprint. Branches of the Same Tree was a record that was I created a sound that came out of Ghana, the Afro-Roots sound, that was able to get a nomination.
Okay.
So we have a blueprint that we can be able to push, but it's just a matter of people recognizing that.
And yeah, I think, because a lot of people were asking, they wanted to know whether if there was a trick to it, like what was it that you were doing, but we'll get into all of that some more when we come back. Yeah. We're still watching Simply Showbiz. We're having a one-on-one conversation with a two-time Grammy nominee, Rocky Dawuni. Elevation in the background. You're still watching Simply Showbiz right here on TV3. We're having an amazing one-on-one chit-chat session with the man himself,
that was filmed in India, I'm told. Yeah.
How did you get to India to film this?
I was on tour there. Okay. I went to do concerts over in India. The last few years, I collaborated with another Indian Grammy-nominated artist that we had a big song there. Mm. And we've done shows at stadiums.
Rocky Dawuni everywhere.
and this was actually, the beautiful thing was that we had done a show in Bangalore and we had another show in another city.
Okay.
So by then this song had finished and we planned, I had the directors, everything, in Indian directors and everything, they had planned and they were like, right after your show, we have only very short period of time between each show. So it's either you do one show and you don't sleep and we drive all night long to all the locations.
Wow.
Whilst everybody was flying. Mm. So we went, we drove all the way from Bangalore to Goa, which Goa is the coastal town, and we're going through all these amazing historic places and in the place where there's all these Indian black, you don't even notice that there's more black skinned people in India than light-skinned people.
Yeah.
All these such an amazing, rich, incredible culture. And I try to capture that in this video about elevation, because some places too, we filmed it where they have the untouchables, who were people, who were workers. So it was a veiled thing to expose some of this stuff that was going on in India, but I used that in a way to tell a bigger story.
Right. Yeah. We want to understand, the inspiration behind your newest project, which has been nominated at the 64th Grammy. But before that, when we went on the break, I was asking, it's a conversation that's being had.
Yeah.
You have done records over the period. One has was nominated in 2015, and this one being nominated at the moment.
Yeah.
Now, people want to know, is there a trick to it? What is that thing you have to do to attract that thing?
I don't think there is a trick to it. I just think that, certain artists, when you have the trajectory or the backing of a bigger major label, they can be able to have that kind of so much push to create that visibility and all of that, to be able to be in all media and then be able to be out there, people know, their music and all of that. So that also helps to some extent, when you work at it for a long time. But some of us too, who came as independent, kind of warrior-minded musicians that wanted to do it our own way, you have to figure out that your thing boils down to making sure that your music speaks for you when you are not there.
Okay.
So you have to make sure that your music is what breaks the doors and not necessarily the trappings and then the fame and the plumps of pop culture.
Okay.
So I knew that if I innovated and I focused on creativity and learned the craft, so I never stopped learning. And I think that was what helped. And because I was not, I had my own, independent label that I would do partnerships with other people and all of that, but I had my own independent label.
Okay.
I could define the sound that I wanted.
The sounds that you wanted.
And I wasn't following some genre.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So my sound wouldn't be like what everybody was doing. So I was crafting something, because I knew that once, it's a longer way, but once you are able to manifest that, then nobody else can decide as to what you should be. Nobody can box you into their corner. You box yourself in your own corner. And my corner is that I can do any type of music that I want, because I've opened myself that, you know, the sound of Afro Roots is all embracing. Mm. And I think that that is what has made me my music, because it's okay. The quality, the production, the songwriting, and all of those things has helped it to elevate and open doors and break through boundaries. I think that has been, if there's any other secret, that's the only secret that I have.
Okay. Yeah. And your Beats of Zion album was used to, you know, galvanize global change and, you know, awareness on issues, you know, of our time. Let's do a little, you know, talk about that. Your humanitarian side, your activism side. Talk to us about that.
Well, you know, I have always believed in the power, the innate power of, I don't like using the words celebrity, because celebrity is like, you know, people just misuse that word and all of time it's like,
we have had
celebrity.
Our fair share of that.
But, you know, when you distill what it really means is that you do something, something very meaningful, and the society places a certain responsibility on you to have insight. You know, you are given a certain platform. I felt that that platform is also a very valuable medium that you can translate, you know, that power of connection to people and communication to social causes, to issues that are facing communities, and also to, you know, catalyze social change. You know, so with that vision, you know, as part of my artistic direction, and then granted with that too, you know, I'm a, you know, I had my education, you know, secondary education, and then also university education, University of Ghana. It allowed me, it gave me like the ability to be able to not only the music, but also to articulate things.
Okay.
So my music also talked about social change. So I felt that you can only talk about things without having the mechanism to implement that on the ground. So through all of that, I started collaborating with a lot of international organizations who seek me out in terms of the work style. So then eventually I became a UN ambassador. I have also had the opportunity of serving on a lot of United Nations leadership councils when the Global Alliance for Clean Cooking was set up by Secretary Hillary Clinton. Myself and Julia Roberts were the first ambassadors. And I also served on the leadership council with a lot of head of states and, you know, leaders. I'm also currently on the leadership council for Robert F. Kennedy Human Rights, you know, so I serve on that with President Clinton and a whole lot of other luminaries on that. And then apart from that too, I am their United Nations Goodwill Ambassador for Environment for All of Africa. And I also work and represent the United Nations too in that capacity. I just know that the important thing is that I want to be have a seat at the table to also be able to bring the ideas that I have. At the same time, to being able to have an insight to as to the geopolitics and
so how with all these things that you've mentioned, you've done amazing, you know, amazingly well with your activism and your humanitarianism. Back here, you know, there are some environmental issues, and we'd like to know how, you know, you plan on touching on these.
Oh, I've been doing them. I mean, I was just in Bumbon. I just did a huge, you know, plastic initiative with the kids there. You know, so we just literally cleaned the whole town, you know, like making sure that there was no plastics, because, you know, plastics are a big, huge problem.
Yeah.
And then also here too, you know, I mean, when you hear a lot of my interviews too, I've been advocating for the protection of our forests.
Yeah.
You know, especially even when you look at the Tiwa Forest, which is like one of the most biodiverse places on earth. I mean, this place could be the crucible of maybe future sickness and diseases will find the cure through the biodiversity. So that's the value of protecting those things. Those things, their value is not necessarily the trees that you see. The value is what is contained in them. And we need to understand the, you know, the wealth that is in that. And the wealth is not in exploiting it or going and digging some metals that are underneath for immediate needs, but preserving it too for future generations. You know, our waterways, you know, water, clean water is becoming a big issue around the world. And we have so much of those resources, but we are not managing it well because of all the mining and all the using of pesticides and all that. Yes. All these things are washing into the water, mm-hmm. and we're filtering right back into drinking water,
so
and
it's causing diseases. So what are we doing right? What do we do?
We just need to have strong environmental laws and enforce them. You know, and protect all these forests, you know, that we have. You know, overlogging, start a tree planting campaign. Every Ghanaian, if you cut down a tree, there should be repercussions.
Think they have something like that, where you get to, you're asking people to plant trees?
Yes. For me, everybody needs to have a tree. You know, each human being, whoa, we are sinners, we
India.
Also, we India, but we are India. And that's how, you know, Nyankopo because Oba, we are sinners, you know. So for me, I believe that we have to proactive, protect it because God gave us that gift, not for us. Mm. God gave us that gift so that we utilize it for ourselves, but at the same time, to protect it for future generations. And not strip everything, destroy our land, sell our land. You know, this is another thing too, because land is never created anymore. And we sell that hardcore foundational piece of, what's it called, a gift that we can, every future economic development is going to be based on land.
So, you know? Speaking of the environment, so we in the news, Keta had been, devastated by the tidal waves.
Very sad situation.
Yeah, we're asking, at the end of the day, you could tell that it's been a problem for a while now, but it doesn't seem like anything is being done about it.
Yes, you know, I was just at a COP event and I had opportunity of, you know, a lot of high-level events. You know, I had the opportunity of speaking to leaders. Actually, also ended up having a personal meeting with one of the English royals, Princess Eugenie, to have conversations about, you know, what, you know, in terms of the affairs around, you know, what's going on around the world. And I just think that there is a disconnect between, you know, when we talk about climate, now I'll go into all the climate stuff. It's a disconnect between how the Western world are looking at this and also how, you know, some of the African countries too are seeing it, you know, because of the labeling, you know, climate change, you know, big word, you know, and you don't know really what it means, you know. But at the end of the day, there has been the important thing that there are changes going on in our world because of cutting all the trees, you know, carbon, and all of that, you know, we have a lot of carbon. We need to plant more trees to recycle this carbon. Mm. So the thing for me is proactively reforesting, you know, making sure that, you know, the land, the waterways are clean, you know, that pestilence, stop using pesticides and all of that kind of stuff. And then I feel that that is what we need to do as a means to counteract all of this.
Your expectation, for the 64th Grammy?
We're bringing it to Ghana.
Yes.
What else?
Yes. Yeah, thank you so much, Rocky Dawini, for joining us on today's edition.
My concert. We didn't get to talk about my concert.
Let's talk about your concert briefly.
So we are doing for this honor to Ghana on December 11th.
Okay.
We are doing a concert at Plus 233.
Okay.
You know, to really bring this energy of, you know, and also positive energy in this time, and also usher the holiday season, because we have a lot to be proud of, and we have a lot to cheer as a country. So yes,
we have a lot to be proud of. Yes, we have a lot to be proud of right here. You heard it from Rocky Dawini. Thank you so much for joining us on today's edition as well. My name is Akofa on Twitter and on Instagram at @IamAkofa_. And thanks going out to Trendy Avenue for my outfit. I'll see you again next Saturday.